My sisters and brothers, the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus summoned the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over unclean spirits. He instructed them to take nothing for the journey but a walking stick. No food, no sack, no money in their belts. They were, however, to wear sandals, but not a second tunic. And Jesus said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave. Whatever place does not welcome you or listen to you, leave there and shake the dust off your feet in testimony against them." So they went off and preached repentance. The 12 drove out many demons, and they anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The good news, the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Declan.
A couple of years ago, I gave a homily, and I said in that homily that every parishioner should get a t-shirt that says, "Work in Progress." What do you think of that idea? Yeah, you can give it, you can applaud, that's all right, you know. I kind of like that. All of us are works in progress, and my congregation at that time took it seriously because 2 weeks later, one lady gave me a t-shirt that said, "Father Al, work in progress." And it's very important for parishioners to know that priests and pastors are works in progress too. Amen?
Amen.
That was a little strong. You know, because even though I've been given a special role in the church through ordination, I'm also a fellow pilgrim with all of you on the road of life, which has its peaks and valleys. And so I think we can all agree that we are works in progress. Pope Francis has been talking a lot about this idea since the beginning of his pontificate. And he uses a fancy, highfalutin theological term to express this reality, a spirituality of graduality. Now, what does that mean? Well, Pope Francis says that human and spiritual development work gradually. It's a slow process. You know, you can't expect a baby to direct the music ministry. It takes time for baby Gary to become big Gary. And this is the grace and the challenge of ministry in the church, because everybody in the church today is at a different point in their human and spiritual development. So when we minister, we have to be alert and sensitive to the uniqueness of every human being, because we're all works in progress. gradual, gradual. And today, in the first reading, we meet the patron saint of works in progress, the prophet Amos. There's a cookie named after him. That'll help you remember it, right? What's it called? Very good. And let's have the first slide. So here he is, Amos the prophet. Now, you notice that this is a Greek-style icon. Amos is venerated very much in the Eastern Christian Church, known as St. Amos, of course. And as you can see in this icon, Amos is about 70, 72 years old. And what does Amos do for a living? He takes care of sycamore fig trees. So the next slide, please. Here's a sycamore fig tree from the Holy Land. You can see it's a very ample, full kind of tree. Now, what was Amos like? Well, Amos is what we would call a curmudgeon. You know what a curmudgeon is?
Kind of crusty. You know, I've been around the block, you know. This ain't my first rodeo.
You know, maybe he cursed a little bit, I don't know. And he was very tan because he was out in the sun maybe 10, 12 hours a day. And he picked figs, and he picked figs, and he picked figs. One day, the Lord God came to Amos and said, "Hey, Amos, I'd like to talk to you." And Amos said, "Please, Lord, you know, I'm busy. I've got figs to pick." And the Lord said, "Well, just give me a moment of your time, if you would, Amos. I know that you're a citizen of the southern kingdom of Judah." Oh, I forgot to mention the figs. Thank you, Edna. Here are the figs. Yes. According to biblical scholars, they aren't that good. These aren't the nice, sweet figs you get in public. So anyway, those are the figs. Thank you. I forgot all about it. And so the Lord says to Amos, "Even though you're a citizen of the southern kingdom, I want you to go to the king of the north and tell him you are unjust. You use the people's taxes to line your pockets with gold, and you ignore the cry of orphans and widows. Go, Amos, and proclaim this truth." And Amos said, "You gotta be kidding me, Lord. First of all, I've never been to the northern kingdom. I'd probably get lost. Number two, I'm a farmer. I'm a shepherd. I don't know anything about being a prophet. And third of all, I'm illiterate. I'm not an orator. I'm not a speaker. What am I going to say to the king? He's going to laugh me out of the northern kingdom." And God said, "Well, those are good points, Amos, but go anyway." And so Amos went. We'll have the next slide. And here's Amos kind of pointing his finger at the face of the northern kingdom. "Hey, buddy, you go tell that king of yours that God is not happy with him. He's not paying attention to the cry of the poor." And the king sends his ambassador out to Amos and said, "If you know what's good for you, you better get out of Dodge." And so Amos went back to the southern kingdom, and he began to write. The Lord gave him the gift of letters, and he wrote against the great injustices of the northern kingdom and its king. And so, my friends, today I would like us to ponder a question. Who is Amos? Amos is you and me. Now, what do I mean by that? I believe, it's a deeply held belief of mine, that every human being is called in a unique way. Would you say amen to that? Amen. Everybody is called uniquely. But I have found that when God calls me, I can come up with 1,000 reasons to say no. Anybody else do that? Oh, it's not quite time, Lord. I'm busy picking figs. And so, today, I want to invite you to respond to God like Amos. He was very reluctant, but he found some passion within him to say yes. And I call this passion, the next slide, holy chutzpah. Can you say that?
Holy chutzpah.
Gee, it wasn't very good. No. Holy chutzpah. Again?
Holy chutzpah.
Oh, that was good. Somebody over here got me. Excellent. Holy chutzpah. Now, what does chutzpah mean? The next slide. It means unabashed effrontery, audacious, in your face. And we saw the slide of Amos putting his finger in the face of the Northern Kingdom's ambassador. Now, I'm not saying that I want you to be rude, but I am saying when God calls you, respond audaciously. We need a little holy chutzpah in the church today. You know, by nature, I'm kind of a depressive person. And if I didn't respond, I would be in my room behind a locked door going like this. Ah! You know, we have to take a step in faith. You know, many of you know the great English writer G.K. Chesterton, and he said something I love. Anything worth doing is worth doing poorly. Now, what does that mean? Am I saying go out and do a bad job? No. But you know, maybe your first step in response to God will be a little faltering. Do you all remember toddlers? Oh, look at this. Right on time, you know. We don't know if he's going to make it. Exactly. But just because he fell doesn't mean he's not going to get up again. And that's holy chutzpah. It's in our DNA if we ask for it. And I hope you can see how important this concept of holy chutzpah is to stewardship, because we're asking people to take a step in faith. And of course, that first step is difficult. But anything worth doing is worth doing poorly. And so, my friends, I'd like to conclude with the next slide. It's a great teaching from the beginning of 1 Corinthians. I wrote a 50-page paper on this verse, but I'm not going to read it today. But this is the heart of the teaching. God chooses the foolish of the world to shame the wise, and God chose the weak of the world to shame the strong, and God chose the lowly and despised of the world, those who count for nothing, to reduce to nothing those who are something, so that no human being might boast before God. God chooses the weak to confound the strong. You know, I can tell you, in my 20s, my life was a mess. If I told you about it, your hair would stand on end. Mine would too, but I don't have any. I was the least qualified person to be a priest. But God doesn't call the qualified, He qualifies the called. And so, my friends, you are being called today. And so I invite you this week as you pray to listen, to be silent so you can listen to the voice of God who is calling you out of your comfort zone. And when He calls, I dare you to say yes like Amos. Whatever is worth doing poorly. And so my wish for you, my friends, is that this parish be graced with holy chutzpah. And the church says, amen.